Well, good morning. My name is Welsh, and I am one of the youth workers here at St. James. This morning, we're looking at Mark chapter 8, verse 27 to 38. Please grab a Bible and let's look at God's word together.
Jesus and his disciples went on to the villages around Caesarea Philippi. On the way, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" They replied, "Some say you're John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Peter answered, "You are the Messiah." Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about this. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then he called the crowd to him, along with his disciples, and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels."
One of my favorite games as I was growing up is a game called Follow the Leader. It's a very simple game. What happens is you pick a leader and you follow them. Wherever they go, you go. And whatever they do, you do. And I find it interesting that we play Follow the Leader all the time in our daily lives. We play Follow the Leader at work, at school, in church, in sports, because they're always leaders in every activity that we're engaged in. And we're constantly faced with deciding which leader to follow. But for us Christians, Jesus is our leader. And this passage tells us exactly what it means to follow him. The first part of Mark's gospel climaxes on Jesus' question to his disciples, "Who do people say I am?" To this, they respond, "Well, some say you're John the Baptist, others say you're Elijah, and others think you're one of the prophets." Jesus takes it further. He says, "What about you? Who do you say I am?" And to this, Peter responds with an outstanding answer. He says, "You are the Messiah." And Peter has got this right. Jesus is the promised king. He's the one who the whole of the Old Testament has been pointing God's people to. He's the one who is going to put God's plans into action. He will deal with the problem of sin and the world and in individual lives. He will restore creation, and God's kingdom will come through him. Now, you would expect that Jesus would add on this great answer by giving us a detailed outline of how he plans on putting these plans to action. We also expect him to live a very long life, a very long and productive life. But this is not what happens. Have a look at verse 31. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this. Jesus says that he has come to die, and that it is through his death that you put God's plans to action. This must have been shocking for the disciples at the time, and that's why Peter calls him aside to rebuke him. But Jesus isn't finished yet. Not only is he going to die on the cross, but anyone who wants to be his disciple must follow him to the way of the cross also. Listen to what it says in verse 34. "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me." He says that whoever wants to follow him should first deny himself. And just to be clear, Jesus is not talking about giving up chocolate or deleting your Netflix as we sometimes do for Lent. But following Jesus means choosing not to let what I want be the determining factor in who I am and in what I do, but it's choosing to let what he wants be the determining factor in who I am and in what I do. Secondly, Jesus says he must take up his cross and follow me. Now, many people understand that Jesus means that they should carry some form of burden in their lives, you know, something like a strained relationship or having some physical illness, or for the young people, doing your homework or not having a boyfriend or not having the latest iPhone. And they'll say something like, you know, well, this is my cross and I have to carry it. But this is not what Jesus means when he says, follow me. You see, his audience would have understood exactly what he's talking about. Because to a person in the first century, the cross meant one thing and one thing only. And that was death by the most humiliating way that human beings have ever come up with. You see, the Romans would make a convicted criminal carry their own cross to the place of crucifixion, signifying total submission to Rome's power. So Jesus uses the same imagery to illustrate the ultimate submission that is required for all those who want to follow him. Jesus is saying that if you want to be my disciple, you should be willing to die to self. Friends, this is a call to absolute surrender to the Lordship of Jesus. Jesus is calling us to let him be the determining factor in who we are and in what we do. But what does it look like, you may ask? Well, think about someone you struggle to love. Maybe it's that difficult person at work, and there's just something about their attitude that puts you off. Well, you could choose what you want and not what Jesus wants, and avoid them, keep them at a distance, and talk about them. Or you could choose what Jesus wants and pray that God will change your own heart first rather than theirs. Try to listen and understand them. Try to accept them. Now, you might be asking, why should we do this, Welsh? Why should I carry my own cross? Well, listen to verse 34 to 38. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange of their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes to his Father's glory with the holy angels. Through his death, Jesus has put God's plan of salvation into action. He has died and has been resurrected to new life, and he'll come again in glory. His kingdom will come. So why wouldn't you want to surrender your whole life to him and do things his way? Because if you try to save your own life now and gain the world now, if you are ashamed of Jesus now, if you choose what you want and what not what he wants, then you miss out on eternal life. But if you lose your life for Jesus and for the gospel, and daily die to self, then losing your life means saving it. And Jesus will not be ashamed of you. In fact, you will share his glory with him. So as we wait for the Lord Jesus, what we are seeking to do is to deny ourselves, to carry our cross every day. And we do this out of gratitude for what Jesus has done for us on the cross. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would help us through the power of your Spirit to live for you, to constantly be seeking to do what you want and not what we want. We pray, Lord, that you'd be transforming us to be more like your Son, Jesus, that we would live to please you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen.